So you can make comics. All right, so we're starting then, right? Yeah, okay. When Esther mentioned it, I was like, wow, you know, first of all, I don't know how to do this. Second of all, I was like, wow, that's a great question. For me, it's weird for me to be the moderator because I feel like I'm in a bad relationship with comics where I'm like, you know, I'm actually thinking of, can I not make comics? It's like a different way of thinking about that question. But before we get started, I want to give you guys an opportunity to, you know, introduce yourselves and your work, maybe why you make comics, real quick, in five words or less.
Five?
I just wanted to see if you said anything. Yeah, no, take a few words.
Okay, I'll start. My name is Aimee de Jongh.
That's how you say.
Yeah, okay. It's spelled really difficult, but it's just Aimee de Jongh, and I'm from Holland, so I came all the way here to promote my book. It's this one, it's called The Return of the Honey Buzzard. It just came out yesterday,
oh, wow.
So it's really exciting. No. Now my face goes red, so please don't do that again. Yeah, so in Holland, I'm a comics professional. I make a daily comic for a newspaper, the Metro newspaper, and I've been doing that for years, and it's pretty hard to be funny every day, so I wanted to make a graphic novel, and after a year, this is what came out of that, so that's me.
My name is Eleanor Davis. I have two books that are new, this SPX. One's called Libby's Dad from Retrofit. I have another one that's Frontier number 11, aka BDSM, that's from Youth in Decline. I make comics because I got into the habit.
My name is Cathy G. Johnson. I have this new book out with Koyama Press called Gorgeous. I make comics because I think articulation. I think being able to use words and images to articulate thoughts and feelings and ideas is kind of how I naturally think. So it's always been part of my life.
Okay. You passed the first of the quiz. All right. So you mentioned articulation. So with comics, one of the things that I think about when I'm making it, like why I do, are unique things that I can do with comics, right? Mm-hmm. Articulation, I would like, do you guys agree, and could you elaborate on that? And if not articulation, what is it, you know? What is it that makes you come back? Because you seem like you're all talented enough to maybe do something else in regard to design or, you know, writing.
I don't know. To me, there's no other medium that combines art and literature and story like comics. I mean, I've been in animation. Mm. I've done illustration. But it's always, it's always a compromise between like an image or a story. And I feel like only in comics you can really combine the two and they work together. And you cannot have just a good story or just good images. It has to be both of that. And I don't know, I'm not sure what I'm saying, but I'm just, you know, thinking out loud here.
Well, the words are there in animation, right? But the words in comics are in the space.
Yeah, yeah, and I think what, you know, with animation and film in general, is that you're very passive, so you're watching it from a distance, and you, once the images have passed, you can't go back. Mm. Well, you can rewind it, of course, but it's gone, you know. And in a comic, you can just take your time and look at every panel, and maybe go back a few pages. And yeah, I think that's interactive in a way, and I like that.
Maybe is there more agency in regard to time?
Mm-hmm. Maybe.
I think one of the reasons I like comics so much is actually what could be considered a flaw in comics as a medium. I am an extremely emotional person, and I get really overly emotionally involved with media, and but I don't get as sucked into comics as I do with prose or movies or animation, which for me means that I can better engage with difficult material. So something that when a movie would make me too scared or too upset or cry too much, with a comic, because you do have that control and you can put it down, there's a distance. And then also with prose, like, you're reading it and it's inside your head, it's happening inside your head, which can make me feel really out of control.
Can trigger images.
Yeah. And feel upset. So in some ways, one of the reasons why I like comics so much is because it's a less powerful medium.
Well, maybe a less
That's right,
a gentler, maybe a gentler medium.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
One that's a little bit more. You do have more agency, I think, as a reader.
Kathy.
I guess.
Look at your shirt, and how does that like correspond to what was just said?
Is that your question for me?
No. That's comics. Yeah. No.
I think I've always enjoyed, you know, the cliche of the a picture's worth a thousand words. Cliche. But I really like the nature that you, visual literacy, you can spend a very long time with one image, and you can draw out a lot from one image, and you can, flip back and try to understand it more and gather more. But audiobooks, I feel like. Mm-hmm. Are you better with audiobooks? Because sometimes you can't dwell on something, and it just keeps passing by, and I like that you can dwell and think about it.
That reverse 30-second button, though. Just keep pushing. That's what I do with audiobooks. I just like, pictures.
There's an intimacy with comics that you can pore over, and I think that's one of the reasons why comics nerds can be so, of which I am one, can be so, there's a consistent OCD sort of quality to us, and I think that being able to dwell on a page and memorize every single detail is something that's super pleasurable about comics that you can't do in any other medium.
So, all right, so now we know why you do it. How does that... So, and that's been able to sustain all of the issues that may, I don't know, for me as a cartoonist, I find like sometimes it could be a way of self-harm, you know, like in regard to just like surviving, you know, like there's a bit of asceticism to like the lifestyle of comics. I mean, I don't think it has to be, you know, like I imagine the 90s, just like some guy at Image like doing coke and like selling, drawing a page and then getting like a check for like, you know, $20,000, you know what I mean? Like, I imagine that. I mean, I'm sure that's what comics is for some people, but, like, I mean, for a lot of people, maybe here at SPX, it's more kind of like, okay, well, what am I going to cut out of my life in order to do this, you know? What job am I going to turn down that actually is going to pay me money so that I'll have, like, a couple hours to do this comic? How do you come back from that? You know, like... this is a question for myself as much for you.
You want to go first?
Yeah, maybe? No. Actually, I don't have the answer. That's what I'm asking you guys.
Okay.
So, all right.
So why do I keep?
Well, I have a question specifically for you. In regard to that, right? Mm-hmm. So you have a comics job, and then you have comics that you're doing on the side. Right?
Yeah.
How do you manage that? Does that burn you out? You know, like you have to do it every, did you say weekly or daily?
Daily.
Daily, Jesus Christ. Okay, so, and you got to think of jokes, which is like very difficult.
You know? And I'm not a funny person, so it's even more difficult.
You're lying now, see? So, I mean, how do you maintain the energy? It seems like are you drawing from the same well? Or is it two different things you're able to draw
from? Yeah, it's really, to me, it's really two different things. It's like, almost like being in an office and then being an artist in the weekends. It kind of feels like that. So I know it sounds terrible, but you know, the daily comic that I do is really just to pay the rent. And I know so many people want to have that job and they're like dreaming of working for a newspaper and but still, what I really want to do is make graphic novels and detailed images and a long storyline and characters that evolve, and I just can't do that in 3 panels. And also, it's printed on a very small piece of paper, so you know, I can't add any detail to anything because it just looks like a mess. So those gag comics are very simple and very basic. I spend a lot of time thinking of those jokes. It's really, sometimes they come immediately, but sometimes it takes 3 hours just to have one good one. So sometimes it's really hard.
And 3 hours, oh my God.
Yeah, but like I said, I really struggle, you know. Yeah. And
you have to draw it.
And then I have to draw it, but the drawing is okay because I can put on the radio or some music, and that's fine. After a couple of years, I was ready to make a graphic novel because, I just felt like I was so limited in what I could do there, almost like in a prison of.
You come from a long tradition though, of cartoonists who were working in that format, who wanted to do more, or, you know, in a tight, constricting format. I think.
But I do feel bad, you know, complaining about it because it's a great job to have, you know. But yeah, I'll complain anyway.
All right. So, did anyone wanna jump off of that? But I have something maybe specific to ask Eleanor, in regard to that actually.
Yeah, go for it.
So when you were mentioning before how you you're able to detach from that, right? Like that as a creator though, is it the same for you? Is working in that medium, like, is it troublesome to engage? You know what I mean? Like, is it a different sort of connection?
I'd unfairly, for being such a wimp about painful or traumatizing media, that's my favorite kind of stuff to draw.
Mm. Like, this is gonna really upset people. It'll make them so sad. I'll make them cry.
So it's like a therapeutic.
Like an exorcism.
Get that painful stuff out.
Give it to someone else.
They can deal with it. So I don't know if it would be more difficult to write prose or to make something else. Or I don't know if the distancing works in the same way for an artist, or if it's just as the reader. I think it's mostly just as a reader that the distancing is helpful.
Yeah, well, it's good for you. It's therapeutic. Maybe that's part of it too, like part of the process. Mm-hmm. Maybe could that be why you have to do it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it definitely is helpful. It's a lot cheaper. You know, one of the
I like to put, you know, I get, you know, callbacks. You know?
Yeah. The what you were saying about like being able to afford to draw comics. So you can think of it one way, like, oh, like I can't take this job that'll pay me money because I have to make this comic that's not going to pay me anything. Or you can think, well, if I draw this comic, I pay $75, save $75 on therapy.
Right.
You know, because therapy is very expensive.
I never thought of it like that.
Interesting.
Very sneaky.
Yeah, very sneaky. Smart. Cathy.
What's my question?
Yeah, like kind of the difficult... I don't know. the difficulty of balance. So, like, when you have, I mean, where? So, what are you doing? Just your gigs, like. So, are you doing? You do like art classes and stuff.
Yeah. I'm a teacher. I'm a faculty member, but I only work after school, so I work 3 to 5.
Yeah. Okay.
So usually,
it's kind of chill.
Yeah, it's really chill. And then that's like my like basic life expenses. Mm-hmm. It's just a 3 to 5 days a week, and then I just draw. But all summer, I did. Summer is weird because I don't work. There's no school. I do like summer camps and stuff, but
I got really to like studio, and I did not do anything fun this summer.
That's not fun though.
It is really fun, but I'm an extrovert, so it's really? Fun. Like I really enjoy it, but that's why teaching. It's like oh, I'm by myself for 16 hours, and then it's like I'm with 50 kids. They're all like screaming, and then it fills up my extrovert really fast, and then I can just be by myself.
So let me ask you a question. This is a little off topic. Is that like the stereotype is that cartoonists would be introverts?
Yeah.
Do you think are you rare? are you a rare Pokemon?
I don't know. You know what? I'm a Dragonite. I don't know. I think a lot of more people should maybe explore more extroverted activities because a lot of people say they're introverts. But then they start to freak out. So maybe you should talk to more people than a barista.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it'd be good for you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's really good for me. The balance is really good. I feel like summer is like kind of a test. Mm-hmm. And then once the school year starts, I'm like, oh my gosh, my life is great. Mm-hmm.
It's difficult sitting inside, you know, doing that work when like, oh, it's beautiful out. Especially for me, it's the end of summer. When the air is cool and the sun is, you know, and you just know, like, if you're in New York where I am, and I imagine, like, for you, it gets pretty.
We should go to Holland because it's raining every day, so you can't go anywhere.
Yeah.
I make, like, 10 bucks a year. Right.
Yeah, you shouldn't work on the tourism board. All right, so what next? We've pretty much solved the point of why, you know, why we have to.
Oh, that was quick.
That was quick. World hunger. Okay. Cartoonist hunger. How do we solve that? The hunger of cartoonists.
I haven't cooked for myself in over a year since I started this graphic novel for a second.
Oh, that's
just
brutal.
Eat microwave burritos.
Oh, no.
That's a kind of something I cut out is cooking.
Because I wonder with you, I'm like, how does Cathy do it? How does she get everything done in a day? Is that you're not
burritos? Yeah, I don't do much. Laundry is a special occasion.
So do you have laundry in your house, or do you have to go to a laundromat?
I got laundry in my studio now.
So you have no excuse. I went last month, no laundry. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I have to walk. You know, it's, you know, New York. Not a lot of places have.
Yeah.
We're interested.
Summer is, I mean, you know, summer. Mm. I have to be more clean when I'm at a school.
Mm. So do you work before or after? Do you start, and you do your work?
I start and maybe I get up at like 8:30, and then I'm always in my studio by 9. And nice. Then I work from 9 to 1-ish, and then I go to the post office and stuff because I mail stuff, and then I go to work, and then after work I like have a fried brain, and then I have like fried brain time from like 6 to 8, and I can't draw no matter how much I try. So it's just like eating and like staring into space, and then from like 8 to like 1 a.m. ish.
Do you guys find that you all have a steady schedule? Well, work forces you kind of, right? Like a regular job.
Yeah, I really feel like I have work days that are like almost like 12 to 16 hours sometimes, because I do a lot of extra stuff like illustration or animation or anything. Yes, and I'm not sure about you guys, but I cannot work in the morning. I just feel like waking up until 12 and then I get to work, and then I want to have lunch immediately. So usually I'm forced to work through the evening and the night, and I go to bed at 4 or
Maybe
something.
Maybe you can't not do a regular job.
No,
I
actually worked in an animation studio, and I told people, like, I'm not a morning person. And they said, no, you're going to learn how to get up at 9. And then, you know, it just didn't work for me because I, until 12 o'clock, like, in the afternoon, I just didn't do anything. It was terrible, and I felt really guilty about it. I just couldn't do it.
But you were on. You were getting paid, so.
Yeah, but that's why you feel guilty. Yeah, no.
Guilt. Eleanor, what is your... So are you primarily doing comics right now?
Mm-mm. No, I make a living off of doing illustration.
Okay.
Editorial illustration primarily. A little bit of advertising.
I've seen your stuff around.
Yeah, yeah. It's sort
of I follow your Tumblr. Oh. I followed your Tumblr for a while. Actually, you sent me the thing on packaging art?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That was great. Like, you could do that for a living. Just like this.
Package,
you know,
art.
like instructional manga? You know, like the kind that you used to get when you got a Walkman? It would have like how you use it?
Yep.
That was brilliant.
Eleanor did
this most amazing thing. I had to ship artwork, and she gave me this most amazing little,
He's doing a residency that I did last year. And they need a bunch of artwork. And so he said, how do you ship this stuff?
Yeah.
And I was on an extremely tight deadline that was due in like a couple hours.
And
I was
still
like, it's too bad that I can't do my important, my job because I have to do this instructional comic for Ron. This is much more important. And then 2 hours later, I was ripping my hair out.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, I'm a brilliant procrastinator.
Oh, it was good. It was amazing.
Thank you. I hope
the whole story.
Yeah, probably your art's all going to get like crumpled by Godzilla, and you'll blame me.
No, I hope not. No one's buying it anyway. You know what I mean?
Like,
anyway,
where's
next?
This residency? I'm just asking.
Hmm?
You
it's the
now.
Thurber, James Thurber residency in Columbus.
In Columbus.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, are you there now?
No. I go there in a couple weeks.
And how long
is
it?
It's 3 weeks.
Oh,
yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, yeah.
They'll let you stay longer.
Yeah?
Yeah, we were there for 3 weeks, and they were like, hey, could we stay for a couple more weeks? And they're like, sure, fuck it.
Hmm.
Stay as long as you want. And we're like, oh, awesome.
Did you see any ghosts?
Sorry, we're just chatting now.
Sort of.
Yeah?
Yeah, some people broke into the house while we were there, which is kind of scary.
Oh.
And there were, like, wet footprints all over the downstairs.
Okay. Ghosts.
Yeah. Wet ghosts. Wet, muddy ghosts.
All right. Well, here's what we're going to do. Is it question time?
Mm-hmm.
I think it's question time. Let's do questions. There are two microphones on either side of the auditorium where if you could go over there and speak into that so everyone can hear your questions, and then, we'll answer the questions. Tintin.
Yeah.
Tantan.
Sure. This is kind of a question for Eleanor and Cathy. I liked your gorgeous. It's mainly about like punks talking cars, stuff like that too. And then Libby's dad is very much girls at a sleepover. And my question was, how do you like approach dialogue in your comics? And because it's such a kind of a key essential point and makes them so absorbing. What's kind of the process? Do you like scrap parts of dialogue? Do you have an editor? I'm kind of just wondering, how do y'all just... how do you cement it on the page?
That's a very good question.
Yeah. Well, I guess I like it. I really want it to sound natural. Like that sentence I just said, it's like to try to kind of create the experience of the pauses and the sort of jarring aspects of conversational tones. So I use a lot of ellipses. I use a lot of I use word balloons to try to break it up into kind of weird sentences. I also do a lot of editing because depends. No one wants to read. That's a blanket statement. But I really don't like big. Sorry, should I swear? Can I swear? I really don't like big ass paragraphs.
The fuck you want.
Because a lot of the times, like, it'll be like a huge paragraph and someone's like, in the panel, and you're like, are they just like this way? And then they say an entire paragraph of dialogue, you know? Like, so I really like to keep it short and sweet as well. And sometimes I'll just be writing it into the balloon and it just doesn't fit, and then I just stop. And that's my style.
So that, but a question about that is like, are you ballooning your work before or after? Like, how do you work out the way the space works?
I'm talking specifically about Gorgeous. So Gorgeous, I did the balloons in the finals. My other graphic novel, Jeremiah, and the one that I'm working on right now, I'm doing the word balloons completely separately. So I'm doing full pages without word balloons at all, and then I'm superimposing the word balloons. Because
do
I'm really
you know, I mean,
yeah.
When you thumbnail, are you thumbnailing the balloons though?
Yeah, I'm thumbnailing the balloons. So like, you don't want
I don't want my word balloon to go over Eleanor's face. So I want to make sure that there's a big boring background behind us. I'm all prepped for it. But also it does make it a lot easier, because then I'm like, oh, I can make it just like a little bit smaller. And I like being able to tweak it. It means a lot more work, but I like being tweaky. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I do a lot of just writing out tons and tons of dialogue, sort of letting it. Dialogue was a really hard thing for me. For some reason, it when I first started writing comics, it all felt really fakey. And I think a big switch was actually reading Scott Pilgrim, for the same reason that you said, that it was the first time I saw a comic where somebody was like writing like, oh, whatever. I was like, oh, that's how people actually talk. And so I just try to write out a whole conversation, and then most of it is not usable. You know, you're just listening, you're letting the characters speak to you, and then you sort of pick out the parts that are actually usable. And I do a similar thing. I try not to use ever more than 150 words per page, because I think it gets too dense.
That's a rule, isn't it? Yeah, I thought I heard someone say something
rule.
Like that. Yeah, that's your rule?
I think it's a good rule. I've said it on Twitter a lot.
Oh, okay.
Like, only 150 words per page! Yeah.
140 characters and 150 words.
Yeah, exactly. But that hurts a lot of people's feelings, because a lot of people use a lot more words than that. But I think they're idiots.
Yeah, what I find difficult always with dialogue is that all my characters talk like me. So whether it's an old grandpa or a young girl, or everybody talks like me. So I definitely need like readers that will tell me like, yeah, they don't talk like that. Or and I tend to explain things too much because I'm afraid people won't get it. So I also need someone to tell me to just delete three sentences in a balloon because it's the same as the first one. So, yeah, but that's just because I'm very, I'm scared that people won't get what I want them to get. And so.
Are you working with editors who help you with that?
Yeah, so for this book, I did work with an editor, and I think we deleted like 2/3 of the text.
That's great. That's a good
and,
editor.
Yeah.
That's
it's better now.
Description.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, I like to draw, but dialogue is just a necessary evil for me.
Have you done silent comics before?
I think I did, but yeah, I mean, I don't mind dialogue. It's just so hard. Yeah.
But you can't.
Now I feel like I can a little bit, but I still need feedback. So, yeah.
How many editors? I've only I got into the habit of just having one person edit my stuff, who's my husband. And in a sort of a too many cooks spoil the broth sort of theory.
At Vertigo, I had 3 editors.
Was that a nightmare or was it healthy? Did it feel good?
No, it was just like people kept getting canned. It was that time at Vertigo. Yeah, it was a wreck.
Did one person edit the whole thing and then somebody else came in and was like, no, edit it.
No,
this
someone
way.
Had a job, like we started out. Then I had someone who I was working with as I developed the script, right? Mm-hmm. And someone who basically just gets, they're asking me questions. Then the last editor, bless their heart, like they came in and like, you know, it was just a shit show over there. So, but this last time at Image, like redoing the book, I had someone going through and it was like, oh, this is what an editor does. You know? Yeah, so. And I have a homie of mine. There's a lot of Elizabethan English in it. So like she, is another nerd for language, so yeah, it was very helpful. It's difficult to find people to do that sort of thing. Yeah. Your husband speaks Elizabethan English?
I don't. He speaks modern American, so that's...
The correct answer is yay.
Verily.
Or nay. Yeah, I did with the BDSM comic I did, it was about... two lady porn stars who are in love, and that was something where he edited it first, and then I was like, something's missing here, seeing as neither of us are lesbian porn stars in love. And then I had a friend who is gay, so she, I think she actually did a better job editing it, because she had more insight.
One out of three ain't bad.
Yeah, I figured, you know, somebody knew what they were talking about. I never got a porn star to edit it, but I did my best.
Oh. Yes. Hey, how's it going? Shoot.
Can you hear me okay if I stop at this?
Yeah, I'm just going to I'm gonna repeat your question. So, like, you'll have to help me. If okay. So. So how to quit comics? No, 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 no. I wish. How to get over not making comics?
So I started, I talked a big game, but I started grad school 2 weeks ago. And so it's been really, I've been trying to prioritize homework. I actually quit. I was organizing a convention for 2 years, and I quit that to try to make space. So I'm in grad school, and I'm finishing graphic novel, and I'm still have my day job. At this point, I think what is good is the direction is always forward. So as long as I work a little bit on my graphic novel every day, that means I'm always headed in the direction I want to be going. And I think what we take for granted how habitual we've made drawing for ourselves. Like, I haven't drawn for a week because I've been in the classes and I came here, and I'm like kind of in the editing stage, not the drawing stage, and I miss it so much. Like, those are my friends that I don't get to draw right now. But it's also like super habitual. Like, I'm just like, it feels wrong when I'm not drawing because I had gotten really used to doing it often. But I think there's nothing wrong with baby steps at all. Like, if you just draw 15 minutes a day, it's going to lengthen. It's hard to just be like, okay, I'm quitting everything, and now I'm going to do this for 16 hours a day. That's going to be a hard jump, right?
Even if you had all the time, you may not be able to.
Even if you had all the time. And part of the reason why I'm in my studio for so long is, like, I'm not drawing the entire time. I'm, like, relaxing and like kind of sitting around and like surfing the internet and stuff. But I know, like, part of my, as long as I'm sitting in my studio, art is gonna get done.
You have to be there. You have to be
right?
there to work. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sleeping is a part of work.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Yeah.
Having a space is really smart. If you can figure it out, having a dedicated space. I guess I feel a little differently.
That's
I've
great.
Gone through. I disagree.
That's great.
I've gone through long periods of not drawing and long, long periods of not making comics. I'm not particularly productive, and that's okay. I don't super believe in making yourself do something that doesn't feel good. I feel like I made myself really miserable over long periods by trying to, you know, do something that actually wasn't super fun for me, do something that was really long. I went banged my head up against several different graphic novels that were a misery. Fuck graphic novels. That's why I like doing short comics now, because I can actually, like, you know, wrap my head around them. Or just little doodly comics, you know, just do what feels good. Or not draw at all for a while. I think that's fine. I also think it's, you know, I don't know. This maybe sounds kind of like Facebooky, but like there's not enough time in the day.
Especially if you're on Facebook.
I know. Exactly. I need to read all the inspirational stuff my friends have. I have to cross that off my to-do list. Checked Facebook. But, you know, I mean, when I'm making comics, I'm not being a very good sister, and I'm not making a lot of money, or I'm not doing my taxes. Because we got an extension, and so the taxes are due in, like, 3 weeks. So you're always kind of going to, you know, I mean, there's, I don't know, it's okay to make choices. And doing something means you're going to give other things up. You know, if you prioritize comics, you're going to not be able to do something else.
I beat myself up so that other people don't have to.
Well, thank you. That's very kind of you.
Learn karate.
Because we certainly don't want to have to beat you up.
I don't think you could.
One of the things you mentioned, I think, is important for me, even with longer projects, is like, and this helps when you have to do other things, is like, and it's difficult to get back on track, but breaking down something big into manageable pieces. Mm-hmm. So even if it's a huge story, well, like, it's the story is the number 100, but like maybe there are 10 number 10 stories in there. You know what I mean? Like mm-hmm. how and. Mm-hmm. Finding those moments too, and like breaking that down, and even just sort of the release of doing one of those little stories is enough to propel me on to do more.
Steps.
Yeah.
My husband Drew just put out a book called The Creepy Case Files of Margot Malou, and we're both cartoonists, and it's a beautiful book. It's from First Second. You all should.
I don't
should
know
check
if it's good, but I'm clapping.
It's so good.
It's really good.
But he was having, I think, a lot of troubles with similar problems of productivity and wanting to do something large. And when he started thinking in terms of chapter by chapter and having each chapter be a little standalone short story, then that was what made him able to move forward with this really long, intimidating project. Because comics are really hard.
Mm-hmm.
No joke.
And if you don't, you know, if you're really short on time, you can always try to at least, when you have time in the evenings or whatever, just maybe try to draw, study anatomy or study other comics or study, you know, just so that you will get better maybe in your mind in your comics. Try keep learning, keep reading other comics, and, you know, always whatever comic you will read, for example, you will always take something with you, you know, when you're making your own comics. And I always feel like, I mean, I spend so much money today on other comics, but I feel it's part of what makes my art the way it is just reading so many other stuff and being inspired by other people, and not really on a conscious level, but more unconscious maybe. So you can still relax and work on your career, maybe. That's the best way to say it. So you're not really drawing then, but you're still becoming a better artist.
I think about language too. You know, like thinking when you're hearing people talk, you're kind of studying. So, this gentleman here.
Yeah. Hello. First of all, thank you all for coming. This is my first expo, and I'm really enjoying it so far.
Yeah.
The question I have for you guys is, when did you first start learning how to draw, like, professionally, and how long did it take you to consider yourself at a professional level?
I guess when I got paid for the first time, I thought, hey, I'm a professional, but I'm not sure about you guys.
Real.
I mean, like, tech language-wise, that would be the truth, right? You got paid for it. It's a very capitalist way of thinking about it.
Yeah, but it's true.
Yeah, it is, though.
I started doing... I went to school for comics. I majored in comics at Savannah College of Art and Design. And I was doing professional level comics, I think, by the time I was out of school, but I still wasn't making professional level illustration. So it's kind of like different. It took me a couple years after that to learn how to be a good illustrator.
Did you have George Pratt? Was he there or no?
He was visited.
Oh, okay. I'm just curious. That's my question. I have the mic.
He was very nice.
And
did I derail? Yeah. I derailed you a little bit, didn't I?
No, I didn't have a very good point.
Oh, okay.
I guess I don't know.
I guess I've always everyone says this, but they've always been drawing. I've always been drawing like Sailor Moon. It's probably the first manga or comic that I really liked, and then yeah, so like I read Archie, but I never drew Archie.
Weird.
Yeah, I was like, okay, I'll draw Sailor Moon. And before that, it was just horses. and tulips. And then, let's see, I made zines a lot in, I think my first zine must have been middle school or high school. So I made a lot of zines, and I would sell them to comic shops. And then it just like very slowly just built up into, this is... sort of, I had my college thesis got published 5 years after I finished it, mostly kind of by my friends at 1% Press put it out. And then, so this is kind of, so that was like my first published book, but it has like limited distribution. And then Koyama Press is like the next level of distribution. And now I'm working with First Second. So like, it's been long, very gradual. But yeah, but it's always been like, I draw this thing and I'm gonna show it to people. Mm-hmm. I think that's the step that comics allows.
Doing baby steps, I think, is, or like just starting out, it would be so frustrating. Like if you, I don't know, like I picked up a guitar the other day and I'm 33 years old. I'd never tried to play a guitar before and I was like, horrified.
It's not easy.
No, it was awful. I was like, this is, my hands hurt and it sounds awful. And I thought I could play a song like pretty quickly. So I feel really lucky that with drawing, I started when I was pretty small. So I wasn't trying to aim for like playing a song right away, or whatever the comics equivalent is. So, you know, just, I guess if you're wanting advice on it, like just start with showing your friends and then just putting stuff online and then doing small anthologies and don't like try to jump right to pitching your shit to like, you know, for a second, because it's just going to stress you out. What's the point? Yeah.
And I do feel that right now we're very lucky to be in this era of social media where you can just put all your stuff on Tumblr and people will follow you and retweet you and whatever, and it's so easy to discover other people's work and you get your own work out there, because before the internet, you know, you used to just send your stuff to publishers and, you know, it would end up in a pile of all the other artists. And this is just so much easier. And also I feel like, I mean, I'm in Holland, but I can email just everyone in America and they respond to me just in 5 minutes. And
taking
it's
our
so,
jobs.
So much easier. Yeah, I'm sorry.
But yes.
But yes. And it's so good to be alive and be an illustrator or comic artist right now. So I think you should make a profit of that. As everybody does. I mean, I have some friends who still say they don't want to go on Facebook, and I'm like, yeah, you know, get over it and just use it for your benefit. It's really, it's good to be alive.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you.
I guess this question is for like the whole panel. You all mentioned, you talked a little bit about visual literacy and stuff earlier, and you all mentioned that you all have been drawing since you were young, and that kind of like builds visual literacy, and reading comics, you know, builds that. And that's super important. That's not something that like is really taught. And I think that with like the internet and stuff, like journalism and everything, it's becoming a lot more visual. And I feel like a lot of times that can be very manipulative because people don't know how to see things sometimes. That sounds kind of silly, but I think it's true. I just wonder if you guys ever feel like any sort of responsibility as like an image maker, like how that butts against like how comics and what you're going to put in your work and that sort of thing. Because I think you all kind of
Would it be fostering how do we feel about fostering visual literacy, helping it or deterring it, and how that works for us?
Yeah, that too, but also just even like your own having to deal with your own like personal moral and like ethical framework for things.
Oh,
and, like,
okay.
What jobs you take and that sort of stuff.
Oh.
I think it's, I think the fact that I have a day job, I really kind of purposely only do jobs that I feel good about. Mm. Like, if there's anything that I feel uncomfortable with, it's like I can easily just be like, no, I'd rather just do this, do something else that it doesn't pay as well.
It's called fuck you money.
But also, I live in a really cheap city, and like I kind of purposely built that kind of life that I can make those kind of choices, and that's not what I expect other people to do at all.
I think that was your advice to me last time I saw you.
Was it?
Yeah, he was like, live somewhere cheaper.
Then you can do what you want.
When I tell you where I'm at, you're gonna make fun of me.
And you're in Brooklyn.
First mistake. I've been there for 20 years, though. Come on. You know what I mean? I'm the reason why it's expensive.
It's a very, I'm not sure if I completely understood the question, but it's a big one. It's a big question.
Take baby steps.
Baby steps.
That's the lesson.
I do a lot of editorial stuff, so I feel really strongly about, you know, about that. I think that, and I have butted up against, you know, I do a variety of body sizes and shapes in my work, and so I'm very familiar at this point with the sort of the coded language that art directors use when they're trying to make me draw skinnier people, you know. I've gotten, you know, some pretty rude.
You should do a comic called Lighten Up. Except it's about weight.
Yeah, I've gotten art directors who are like, oh, well, all your people just look like pigs. Yeah, it's like, well, fuck you.
You try it.
Yeah, so that's tough, you know. So, and I often can feel you butt up against... I don't know. I got in big trouble. I tried to do a Thanksgiving piece this last Thanksgiving for the Times, where they just wanted like a family eating Thanksgiving dinner, and I was like, "Oh, well, I'll make all the family Muslim, because I want to show that this is an American family." And oh my God, it was a disaster. It made the art director feel super. They didn't want me to do it. But they didn't want to tell me.
Yeah, I love it. I love that.
You know, oh my gosh. And I felt horrible. And it was a. And we had to go back and forth and back and forth and back and forth.
I'm sorry, but why did you feel bad?
That's my question.
Well, because it's hard to know in that situation what to. Like, at what point do you walk away and say, I am not going to do this job at all unless you let me do it in this specific way? At what point do you. You know, and. And even though I like the art director, so even though they were asking me to do something which I thought was kind of unethical, which was sort of whitewash the people in this illustration, I could tell that they felt really bad. And I don't, you know, I'm a lady and I am been socially trained to not want to make people feel bad. Yeah, so it was a mess. It was just a total mess.
What happened?
I don't even want to go into it. I'm sorry I even brought it up.
We'll talk about it later. Sorry, guys.
But it was very messy, you know, but you do have this sense of responsibility, and it was just like, I cannot do another Thanksgiving illustration of a white family. Mm. It just made me feel too bad. So trying to navigate, you know, but there's a lot of sensitivity, so it gets really, it's difficult. But I try to think about that stuff in a responsible way.
That's heroic to me. Yeah. That's dope.
I don't know.
Respect.
I don't know if I navigated it particularly well.
You tried, though.
I tried. Respect.
Yeah.
Gotta keep fighting that fight.
I just did a couple of children's book illustrations for children's book, but also for books for class, how'd you call that?
Curriculum, like, or something?
Yeah, I guess, yeah.
School books.
And, you know, for kids about 7 years old or 8 years old, and that's really, I mean, I feel so I feel like it's so important that everything that I draw is gonna affect those kids. Mm-hmm. Like all the stereotypes I put in there and all the cliches I put in there, I feel like it's like I'm responsible for their view of the world or mm-hmm. something. And I learned through those illustrations that I was also really influenced by like the images that I got as a kid. For example, when I was a kid, the illustrators would draw like very old telephones and very old garbage cans and stuff, and I would still draw that sometimes and think like nobody uses those anymore. Mm. I mean, it's really funny. Sometimes I really have to just pull myself out of those cliches and think, what does a garbage can look like now, and change that in my own drawings. So I feel really responsible when I'm doing those. But they really, most of the time, they're really helpful, and they say, yeah, this is not what it looks like now, or you should do it like this.
Or they, you mean the editor?
Yeah, yeah. So, but yeah, I'm really aware of being an illustrator is maybe more important than most people think. It's not just drawing a nice picture. It's also, maybe changing something, especially in kids, but also in teens or whatever.
It's like observational, but also aspirational.
Yeah, yeah.
Like that family. Creating that family in that space that maybe you haven't necessarily seen, right? But creating it allows for the imagination of people who see it to believe in it, you know, mm-hmm. the possibility of it, which is very important.
Yeah.
Yeah. And
is that what you meant?
Yeah, yeah, I think so. It's the same as, you know, that for a long time, kids somehow didn't know that female astronauts existed, but
yep.
you know, if we just started drawing only female astronauts, then everybody would think, or maybe slowly start to think
the
it's possible. And
yeah.
so we're really responsible for maybe a small part, but we are responsible for that kind of
we're
thing.
Responsible for astronauts.
Yeah.
Oh, hey, Eskid, what's up?
Hi. Not much, Ron. What's up with you?
I'm chilling.
Yeah, cool. Yeah. I did actually have a question for you guys. It's cool. So, you know, in this industry in particular, like comics, we have like peers and mentors and educators. Like, you know, we learn how to do different things from different people. I was actually wondering along those lines, like how you built your careers and what have you. Are there any, like, did you prefer like just kind of figuring it out and reinventing the wheel or creating something wholly new with how you did your life and balanced it? Or did you have a lot of mentors who kind of taught you along the way, or peers that you worked it out together? You're all like, oh no, this is how you do your taxes, or like, oh dang, this is how you like get.
I
this
wish I
of
had
dog.
That person.
Right? No, yeah. So I guess that's what I'm asking. You know, like, where did you pick up all of your like the financial literacy, but then also like how to get your jobs and like how to do anything in the comics industry? It feels like everyone does it differently.
I have a I very much recommend. Don't ask other cartoonists for financial advice.
Yeah.
Once I started asking my illustrator friends for financial advice or for like figuring out contracts and stuff, I figured there's a whole world of people who are getting treated fairly and could retain their rights and were getting paid a living wage. Not cartoonists, the illustrators. And I try to help, you know, disseminate that, because cartoonists are just, we have such terrible self-esteem. I just, you know, it's, I think that we're just, somehow we're trained to feel rude if we ask for more money, or feel rude if we ask for a kill fee, or if when we ask to retain our rights. So ask an illustrator, that's my advice. And yeah, I've gotten lots of advice from friends over the years.
Did you mean, I'm asking, did you mean in regard to like beginnings or like kind of?
Not even beginnings, but like just every single time, you know, because like even over the course of a career, if you evolve from like an illustrator to a cartoonist, or a cartoonist to an animator, or like even just a comics artist to a graphic novelist, these are all different steps to take, right? So like, did you have people who told you what to do, or like who told you different advice and then you took it or you didn't?
I think that's why, you know, not to give you a plug or anything, but I think that's why something like SPX, or, you know, for instance, Pratt, you know, I'm a Pratt dropout, which is like kind of poetic. like that's an art school. one of the most important things about going there wasn't any sort of like instruction. Sure, there was like a way of seeing that you, I feel I was just lucky to have met, I think you could have gone all the way through art school without learning anything, but I was lucky to have met a few professors who gave me a way of looking. They didn't teach me how to draw, none of that, just like seeing things. But more importantly, it was just sort of the dialogue that I had with other creative people there and often doing things completely different than what I do. And in that sense, I think maybe you can't go to art school, maybe you shouldn't go to art school, you know, given how much it costs. But like if you can go to SPX, if you can engage with the artistic community in another sort of way, I think it's very valuable. And I think in comics, it's especially great because I think it's a lot more natural to kind of go up and talk to someone who does what you want to do. Mm-hmm. Say if it's filmmaking, like you're not gonna roll up to Jim Jarmusch and be like, you know, hey man, so like, what cameras do you use? like, it's not gonna happen.
I have a BFA from Micah, your local art school. But I got my BFA in interdisciplinary sculpture, which I purposely chose because I was like, I know how to draw. I don't need to be taught how to draw, right? But I need to be taught how to think and the more conceptual aspect of art education, because I think art education, there's like, tools are very important, but I think what makes art education great is the ability to see the world in a lot of different ways and to recreate it in different ways to express that. I'm getting a master's in art education right now. but I think that's what's so valuable about it. It's not, being able to do it is pretty important, but being able to express of new viewpoints and to conceptualize new viewpoints of the world, I think that's like what art education is to me. So like, if you're just taking like how to paint 101, it's like, I mean, that's important, but like, that's not what I think art education should be.
I have a really messed up way of thinking about it. It's like at a certain point, once you've reached a certain point, there are people who can flex and really, you know, go through that stage where they develop, you know, like Grandma Moses or whatever. They develop like a skill, an amazing skill at a. But I kind of feel when you are intellectually mature, I kind of think it's best to kind of like think about how you can use the tools and vernacular you have at that point to express things, as opposed to being like, well, I'm gonna draw like, you know, who's a guy who can draw really well?
You.
Rembrandt.
I wanna draw like you.
But like, especially in comics, there's such a place for rudimentary expression. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah.
Rudimentary.
There is a place for rudimentary as well.
Okay, we're gonna do like the tango now. I'm getting something. What is this? Milliwop? What do you want me to do? Okay.
Okay.
Millirock. We're going to Millirock now. Okay. Okay. All right. Okay. Yeah. Well, any final or last words for this? I'm sure you'll speak more after this.
I'm so glad everybody stayed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Glad you didn't walk out.
Buy all of these.
Yeah.
Yay.
Koyama, table 1W something.
I don't know.
W2.
That's what I meant to say. Like, okay, yeah. Where are you? And what are you coming out with? And
I'm W9. I do this, but I also do a lot of screen prints, so I have a lot of screen prints. If you have a boring house.
Wow. I'm L13? Sorry, I'm looking at my husband. He's in the back. Okay, he's giving me the thumbs up. I'm at L13, but I'm not going to be there for the next hour because we're going to walk the floor and try to buy some comics, but after that I'll be there and we have plenty of everything, and come by and say howdy and trade minis with me, and I want to see y'all's work. Appreciate everybody coming out. It's awesome to see.
I'm at the stand of Self-Made Hero. I don't know the number, but I'm going to be there the rest of the day, and I also brought some of my daily comics with me to trade or to give away, so come over and say hi.
I'm at W47. I don't have much left, but I have some great postcards, I think, left. Oh, get Prince of Cats next month. It's coming back out.
Yeah! Yay. All
right. Thanks for coming out, and sorry, this is my first time, so it was a little rough.
It was great. You were great.
You did great. Yay.